will soon see and hear seven speakers representing as many different branches of the arts. These will include a painter, a journalist, an architect, an actor, an economist, economy being an art form today, an author, and a theologian. Theology was once known as the queen of the arts. We don't hear too much today about theologians, but they remain at the very top of the intellectual pyramid. And you are going to hear in the beginning of these tapes one of America's top flight theologians, Dr. R.J. Rushdoony, author of 30 books, inspirer of many thousands of people. I first encountered Rush's books when I had an office in San Diego. I was engaged in an intellectual search, and I found one of his books, I would say by accident, if it were not for the fact that I'm a Christian, and found firm footing after many years of wandering. I hope that those of you who watch this tape, in this series of tapes, will find in what is said similar direction. Now I give you Dr. Rushdoony.
For all too many people in our time, Christian and non-Christian, the arts are seen as peripheral to life, not a necessity, a frill, or a luxury. And the media is similarly regarded as scarcely anything more than a necessary evil. The fact is, both areas are essential to us as Christians. Because God created man in his image, man is created to be a molder and a shaper who gives direction and meaning to all his activities in terms of the image of God in him. And because God, like the God he is, one who speaks, one who communicates a revelation to mankind, created man in his image to communicate, we have the media. Both are necessary expressions of the image of God in man. The arts are not peripheral. We all live in houses. We work in buildings. The clothing we wear, the pictures on our walls, all these are aspects of living, expressions of our life and our faith, of the values we cherish, and thus very important to life. We could not live without either the arts or the media. Communication. In the modern era, especially so in the 19th and 20th centuries, two basic motives have governed the world of art, so that as we consider now arts and the distortion of Christianity, is important for us to analyze these two basic motive forces. First has been the classical quest. This has been dominated by an adulation for Greek art and the ideals of Greek art. Now, the greatness of the classical motif has been the fact that it has been very intensely aware of the order of the universe. And this heritage it has bequeathed to the world as a constituent part of its outlook. Its fallacy with respect to order has been that it has seen it as something behind nature, although in nature. Ideas, universals, which somehow find expression in Platonic fashion in the material world. The Greek concept divided creation into ideas or universals and matter or particulars, so that the order was not in the material world, but in the ideal world, the world of universals. Not in God, not as a constituent part of nature. And this division led ultimately to a destruction of the classical sense of order. Greek art, as a result, aimed at expressing abstract universals, ideas which are beyond time and are not particulars, not a part of matter, but something which uses matter to express itself. In statuary, the goal was to portray not a woman, but ideal beauty, not an individual man, but the idea of man. As a result, in the classical tradition, the goal has been to produce great art, polished, finished, timeless art. Two examples of the classical idea in poetry can be cited. Shakespeare's Venus and Adonis, and Shakespeare's The Rape of Lucrece. In these two works, Shakespeare tried to be classical. Reading those works is an exercise in boredom. Both are marked by a general irrelevance to life and thought as Shakespeare knew it. In his plays, Shakespeare was more relevant and less classical. In the sphere of literature again, Alexander Pope's Essay on Man is the great classical work in English literature, but his success was also his failure. The work shows a superficial and a pretentious nature. The continual striving for greatness rather than the expression of truth under God led the classical tradition step by step into absurdities. To cite another example, a man who in his day was regarded as one of the greats on a par with Shakespeare and others, Martin Tupper. In no way connected with Tupperware, but the same name. Martin Tupper is totally unknown today. But in the Victorian era, his fame was so great that it is hard to imagine that someone who was so highly regarded as one of the all-time greats could be so thoroughly forgotten today, so that nothing of his remains even in anthologies. In painting, the classical attitude led to transforming poor, rundown peasant dwellings into idyllic echoes of paradise. The classical ideal exalted the good, the true, and the beautiful, but as independent universals which somehow had to be seen as incarnating themselves in reality. This led to a choice of upper-class subjects. It led to an emphasis which distorted the real world. For example, 18th century French furnishings. If you examine a dining room table and the chairs, you realize why the habit developed whereby a gentleman would help a lady when she sat at table by moving the chair forward. The gentleman had to be a strong man to lift the chairs of the day. They were heavy, ornate works of art intended to express classical greatness. They were not very useful to sit on. And a woman could not handle it, and sometimes, I suspect, some older men wound up with a hernia after attempting to help a lady to the table. Now, this was what killed the classical ideal. It concentrated too much on greatness and too little on relevance. And we as Christians believe that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, not in a palace, but in a stable, in order to bring the whole of life into the kingdom of God, to radiate the whole of life with the salvation of God, the truth of God, and His grace. Reynolds, Gainsborough, and others in the classical tradition were exceptionally able men. But the ideal began to depart so from the real world that it reached the point of absurdity. When chairs became dining table chairs, so unwieldy that a woman could not cope with them, all we can say is they had left the world of reality. Things had become an end in themselves. The second motive, most often, but not exclusively, associated with the avant-garde, has been for art to be prophetic. The artist as a prophet. He is his own prophet and his own Allah. So he is a prophet of himself. The artist has seen himself increasingly in this modern tradition as the true prophet of himself and given to unfettered, semi-mystical expressions of new truths, but formless, meaningless truths, which amount simply to self-expression, whatever that might be. The artist became a poseur. Now, a poseur, in the true sense of the word, means someone who is called to raise fundamental questions, who poses questions. But the artist as poseur raised questions which had no answer by definition, because life is meaningless. Art is meaningless. There can be no answers. So the point of raising the questions was to drive home the ultimate meaninglessness of all things. One of the great figures in this tradition in the United States was Walt Whitman with his Leaves of Grass. He saw himself as a humanistic Christ figure. In fact, he had a photograph taken of himself in which he deliberately tried to project the image of a Christ. He cultivated his role carefully. Now, here we come to a fundamental difference between classical and modern art. The classical conception of art calls for a careful schooling with apprenticeship as the first step. It calls for a strict adherence to technique and a knowledge of the fundamentals of the particular discipline. The prophetic artist relies on the moment's inspiration. If he puts any work into what he does, he conceals that. And he cultivates the role of complete spontaneity. Because to indicate that there is anything but spontaneity in his work is a confession of failure. To be an expression of the true deity himself, it has to come forth without any intervening discipline or work. Thus, prophetic art in the modernist tradition is ad hoc art. The artist prides himself on a freedom from discipline and from the past. In fact, the more unruly and undisciplined a person he projects himself as being, the more he feels he is communicating that he is an artist. Classical art sees creativity as a product of the highest in man, his reason. Prophetic art seeks creativity as a function of the unconscious. As a result, the whole stream of modern thought, which culminated in Freud, has had a profound influence on modern art. Freud is the patron saint, as it were, of prophetic art, even as Plato and Aristotle were patron saints of classical art. Now, we could say that in spite of their traditions, both have produced some remarkable works. But in neither tradition is the wholeness of man at work. The artist separates himself from other men in terms of a special quality. He invests art with undue gravity. In view of this, it is ironic that even as a new art form, not entirely new, it has a long history, but as it became prominent in our culture, as it developed in the 19th century, began by seeing itself with undue gravity. This was the cartoonist. The first cartoonists, like Thomas Nast, saw themselves as giant killers. They were political cartoonists. And Thomas Nast, first of all, built up a petty Tammany boss as though he were the kingpin of all New York, and then proceeded to slay him. And political cartoonists ever since have taken themselves as good modern artists with undue gravity and are very often painful to follow for this reason. This is a major problem in every vocation. The modern temperament leads humanistic man to take himself, not God, seriously. Whether he is an artist, a minister, or a politician, or whatever he may be, he can be a very dangerous man because of this habit. To take ourselves too seriously is to assume that we are the answer, that as Job told his friends, no doubt wisdom was born with you and will die with you. Well, wisdom was not born with us, and it will hardly miss us when we are gone. The world was not empty when we came into it. And the sad fact is that too many in this age apparently have one goal in life, to leave the world more empty when they leave, because they are essentially destructive. One of the marks of the artist in these two traditions is that in quest of greatness, he feels an unwillingness to be pleased by anything in life. So one of the things that has infected the whole of the modern world, coming from the artists since approximately the era just before the French Revolution, an attitude which has infected all of us, is this sense of superiority by showing contempt for everything around us, for the family, for our country, for the past, for all things, as though the ability to be critical and contemptuous constitutes superiority. It's a cheap attempt at superiority, but a very common one. Lewis Simpson, for example, said of Dylan Thomas's father, D.J. Thomas, and I quote, "There were moments when D.J.'s unwillingness to be pleased lifted him from the ruck of humanity to the sublime," unquote. Now, here was a scholar who felt that of necessity, he had to look down on his wife with contempt. She was not a scholar. He had to look down on all his students with contempt, on all his colleagues, on the whole world. And what does Simpson say? It was this that lifted him above the ruck of humanity. The word ruck means trash, the trash of humanity. This is how the modern artist looks at people, with contempt. And you can never communicate with anybody if you begin by despising him. So communication is ended. And this is why the artist and the media today are increasingly unable to communicate, because they view those to whom they should be communicating as the ruck of humanity. And I would say ruck is more polite a word than they normally use. This was Dylan Thomas, a faithful son to his father. He went out of his way to show contempt for most people and for the world of meaning and morality, to show how different he was from other people and how he despised their habits, their standards of cleanliness and niceness and so on. On one occasion, he claimed he drank his own urine, and he boasted about it, wrote about it, in order to repel people and put himself at a distance from those nice people. He stole in order to break the law and to separate himself from the common herd. And of course, he had to write about it, because he was doing it as a part of his act. In his writings, the emphasis, by his own statement, was on words, not on ideas, on images, not on thoughts. Man did not need to follow the established meaning of God's world, but he felt should spin the world out of his own consciousness, to create his own world and to live in that. And of course, the end result of trying to create your own world and your own rules for that world is, as it was with Dylan Thomas and all such, death. Simpson sums up Thomas's view and his own, and I quote, "We are the creators of the universe, just as in fact we are poets," unquote. Jack Kerouac, another modern writer, said once, and I quote, "The only people for me are the mad ones," unquote. The only people for me are the mad ones. The virtue of the mad, he felt, is their rejection of the normal world and of God. Both Kerouac and Allen Ginsberg felt that the insane, the criminals, and homosexuals are superior people because society condemns them. For the same reason, they approved of drugs. For them and for others, this was the premise, and I quote, "The self is the center of everything," unquote. That is, the anarchistic, self-gratifying self is the center of the universe. As a result, just as in its seedy days, classical art became flamboyant, the modern motif in art began with flamboyance. Both have shown a common premise: dedication to themselves as an elite people, a people who reject the ruck of humanity. The elitist then seeks to incite rejection of himself in order to prove that he is superior, because the ruck of humanity doesn't like me, therefore I am superior to them. There is an absurd syllogism at work. Premise A, most men are ruck, trash, or garbage and are to be rejected. Premise B, we the artists are rejected by the human ruck, the trash of humanity. Conclusion, we are rejected because we are an elite group far above the common herd. Now, this elitism is a rejection of Christianity. Artists in this tradition can only distort the faith, as we see done in art. And of course, turn on the television, go to a theater, pick up a newspaper, and you will see this rejection and distortion. Christianity is anti-elitist. It holds to a hierarchy, that is, as hierarchy tells us literally, a sacred rule. Life to be governed in terms of God's calling, in terms of a vocation, a ministry. The meaning of art as a ministry is a celebration of life and creation, and the artist is a celebrant. 1 Peter 3:7 speaks of life as a grace from God, and of married couples as heirs together of the grace of life. Paul says that in our very persons, we represent an act of grace. For who maketh thee to differ from another? And what hast thou that thou didst not receive? Now if thou didst receive it, why dost thou glory as if thou hadst not received it? Having received it, we are trustees and ministers of what we have. Christian art, then, is marked by a sense of confidence, a sense of victory. And it is notable that even when the church was still a persecuted and an underground organization, the surviving hymns give us that sense of victory. As in one of the earliest hymns we have, "Of the Father's love begotten." Or another which came a little later, St. Andrew of Crete's, "Christian, dost thou see them?" A summons to go forth and conquer. We have seen it even in the last century, and the song that came out of the slaves. He's got the whole world in his hand. When we look, for example, at the miniatures of the hours of Catherine of Cleves, dated about 1440, we are amazed by the exuberant freshness of colors, the rich use of gold, the sense of vibrant joy that comes through. We are then in a different world, a world of joyful certainties, even as adversities and humble circumstances are portrayed. But we must not imitate the past. The Christian artist knows the power, the judgment, the revivifying power of God and his purpose in the context of the present. The major fallacy of avant-garde art has been its quest for originality. We have seen in the past two or three decades, sometimes, new schools of art every year, op art, pop art, and then a succession of others. The result is an adventure into the absurd and the ludicrous. Originality is a questionable concept. It is not the same as ability, not the same as caliber. We can be original by shaving off half our head and half our beard, but is it good? More important, is it for art to manifest insight and purpose? The goal of art that seeks after originality is religious. Because God is the creator, fallen man seeks to be his own God. He seeks to be original and creative. God has no pattern in terms of which to create all things. He expresses himself in creation. Now, when the artist plays at God, he seeks simply to express himself. But apart from God, he is nothing. For what hast thou that thou hast not received? So that when he seeks to express himself, nothingness is the result. It leads to a mindless art. Art can be described as language, a form of communication. When art left the church, when it left Christianity, it began to decline its communication skills and concerns. Those who followed the classical tradition became adjuncts to the court and to nobility, and their purpose became decorative. The great musicians were hired to provide background music to the court. Operas were sung to chatter because it was the privilege of the upper classes who attended opera, to talk freely, to sit on the edge of the stage while the performers tried to sing behind them and hail their friends. They were too important. And therefore, no one dared say, the opera has to take precedent over you and you cannot sit on the edge of the stage. As a result, when opera became a part of the 19th century and the early pre-Romantic era, it became prophetic and it became grand opera. The concert hall replaced the church as the place of absolute silence. Now even the kings were silent when the music began. They did not dare express themselves because the new prophets were the artists. No one sought better to fill that role than Wagner, who saw himself really as a prophet in the Old Testament sense, but as a total humanist, and who felt that what he had to say was the gospel for the future. His operas are still listened to, but since the fall of Hitler, his gospel is no longer relevant. Shelley spoke of the poet as the unacknowledged legislator of the world. But apart from rebellion, he had nothing to legislate. The artist began to talk to himself and paint for himself. Since World War II, one writer, Ted Hughes, spoke with contempt of those who seek clarity of meaning and understanding. And he expressed his contempt, for example, of the poetry of Sarah Teasdale as quailing and whining, and Millais' lyrics as simple, the ultimate word of contempt. As a result, the artist has less and less a language he cannot communicate. By denying that art is a God-given language, a form of communication, modern art has reduced itself to a decorative role. It is used in the production of textiles. It is used by avant-garde interior decorators for bank buildings and corporate offices and the homes of people who have more money than common sense. The high seriousness of art is replaced by a reduction to a purely decorative role. By rejecting communication with the ruck of humanity, the artist sentences himself to isolation, and art becomes separate from the world, from consequences, from relevant affairs. And so the artist has gone to leftist causes and championed them and allowed himself to be used by them, because somehow that puts him back in the mainstream of relevance, but still maintaining his unpopularity by championing such causes. Thus, this elitism leads to a highly critical spirit, critical of others rather than of oneself, of one's own work. And man has become his own God and judge over all. Thus, a community of artists is a fragile, temperamental thing, not a true community. In a truly Christian perspective, this is not possible. The Christian artist is comparable then to a musician in a symphony whose conductor is God. The artisan, the engineer, the farmer, the churchman, every calling as a place in providing for the richness of life, and to exclude any one of these and others is to impoverish life. In this perspective, art is a form of work. The idea of art as inspiration, as spontaneous and semi-mystical, is wrong. Drudgery and hard work, thinking, is a part of all good art. Very simply, art requires work, hard work, painstaking work, and the artist must be trained for it. Kumaraswamy has said concerning the Christian philosophy of art, and I quote, "Art is for the man and not the man for art. That whatever is made only to give pleasure is a luxury, and that the love of art under these conditions becomes a mortal sin. that in traditional art, function and meaning are inseparable goods, that it holds in both respects that there can be no good use without art, and that all good use involves the corresponding good pleasures, unquote. Elitist art makes itself irrelevant. And this is why most people today have little use for art. Such artists cultivate the idea of being sensitive souls, by which they mean they are sensitive, but are insensitive to the world around them and to other people. And the work of art of such people best expresses the artist's precious personality and is a luxury product or a mere ornament. Kumaraswamy says, and I quote, "On these grounds, art may be dismissed by a religious man as mere vanity, by the practical man as an expensive superfluity, and by the class thinker as part and parcel of the whole bourgeoisie," unquote. Elitism precludes most people from understanding art. I referred earlier to grand opera. It was made possible only with royal treasuries. It involved casts of thousands, up to 50 scene changes, chariots, cannons, horsemen, boats, camels, bears, elephants, entire armies on some cases. In Pomodoro, there were burning churches, earthquakes, and thousands were involved in the production. And the performance was written and talked about for years. The performance of the opera Constanza e Fortezza was the greatest musical event in Europe. The performance took from 8 p.m. to 1 a.m. and it virtually bankrupted the treasury. Of course, later Wagner did bankrupt Ludwig of Bavaria, and it led to his enforced abdication. Much was destroyed by all this. Art was made an elitist luxury. The church was separated from art. And churches then, if they retained art, went in for sentimental art, or they rejected it totally. Artists went to socialism because of their hunger for state patronage. With kings gone, they looked to the state to provide for them. And art became a tool for revolution, subservient to the patronage of those interested in propaganda. A tool is something man makes to facilitate his work. Tools are important, and they further work. It does not denigrate art to call it a tool, as the Marxists do. If we do not limit it to that role, it is much more. Tools are used to exercise dominion over the earth, and art has this function also. Art has both a manward and a Godward direction. Art celebrates dominion and is used to further it, but also to celebrate our joy in the Lord and in all his creation and much more. The problems with all definitions of art is that they isolate art from life. We do not isolate speech from life, even though some men are dumb. Speaking is a key aspect of living, and so too is art. We are all involved in speaking, some better than others. We are all involved in art, some badly, others ably, and some professionally. The word artist means one who is skilled in art or who makes a profession of any of the fine arts. Its synonyms are artificer, mechanic, artisan, operative, and workman. The word artisan means a trained workman, a superior mechanic, Note the emphasis with respect to artisan, trained, and superior. This is why the Christian artist should use the term artisan, because it puts the emphasis on the training, the discipline, and superiority. Men we now call artists were once called artisans, the working men of the world with particular skills in important spheres of life. They were not outsiders to the world posing as prophets, but key figures in the world, in the life of society and in the faith of society. The restoration of art to such a relevance will not be easy, but it is necessary. It will be a part of a larger task of reconstruction in every sphere of life and thought. The distortion of Christianity that we face is across the boards. The artist is a necessary person in the task of reconstruction. A man can live without speech. He can eat, sleep, and carry on some activities without the luxury of language. But life would be dramatically poorer. So too would life be without the skilled artisan. Thank you.